What did we do?
Welcome back to the Wednesday Club.
What have we done?
We broke everything.
Are we broke everything?
Yeah.
Are we on the internet? Are we doing it? Did I do it right?
I'm still.
Yeah. Did I do it right?
I'm declaring yes. I'm
still
not
going
even out of this.
Well.
This is so much. Oh, this is amazing.
I got a present at Con and it was the best. We're sharing our halls.
Hi, everybody.
Look, I brought my sign and I brought my badge.
It sounds like you said you brought your son.
I brought the sign.
This is a weird time to find out that you have a son that you brought to the
show. Totally. Totally. His name is Xander.
Wait, we know Xander. Also, that's impossible.
No. His name is Xander
Cage. I'm going with my version.
Xander Cage.
He's a time traveler and he's in a band with Bonnie. Wait, no. I mean, I could kind of see that. Never mind.
Not when I've got coffee, sir.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Wednesday Club.
Back.
We had a long weekend.
Yes, we did. We're still loopy from it.
And we missed Matt very much last week.
Can I just say, like, I already hate missing the show for anything, but when I have to miss the show because I'm feeling mostly fine, but my voice is just gone, that's, like, the worst. Like, because all I would come in and be like, hello, everybody. I read the. I can't talk. And like, I would have just sat here.
Matt, point at the book you like.
I like this one. Tell everyone why, Taliesin.
Well,
write it on a notepad.
Poor
the worst.
Starting to feel better.
You sound better.
I sound better, but the congestion is still.
No, it was
still a thing.
We were feeding you cough syrup all weekend, Austin.
You were.
Yeah.
Taliesin's nutrient tube.
Were you feeding to him at our panel at San Diego?
We had a panel. Oh,
we had our first panel and it went so well.
Thank you so much to everyone who came.
It was amazing.
I found out that room was like a 4 to 450 seat room.
Woo!
And we had it.
Filled it.
We filled it. Like they were turning people away at the door. So thank you so much for your support. Those of you who were there. I was actually surprised that we didn't like. I didn't know they were going to shuffle us off through a different exit. So I was expecting to have fan time afterwards.
We all were. We're sorry for anyone that we didn't find afterwards. It was confusing.
Yeah, I was actually like, I was like, cool, and I'll wait around for like another 30, 40 minutes and hang out with fans. I'm fine with that. And then they push us through another exit. We're like, cool. Where are the fans? They're like, oh, they're over there.
You can't get there from here.
You can't get there. What do you mean we can't get there from here?
There's a much
so
much like
very
much like
sorry.
But we did get to talk to some of you at the at some of the Alpha events and at Nerdist House and a couple of things got passed on.
Oh, what is this? I don't know about this.
It looks
this
like
is from someone who didn't catch us after the panel, but
it looks like a tiny sandwich.
Ooh, I like tiny sandwiches.
The gentleman, I'm going to hide this.
Oh, yeah, thank you.
Sorry.
Oh, good call. Great call.
I could have thought of it before we were live, but I thought no.
Oh, that's a terrible supervillain, Docs Martin.
Oh, God.
Sorry. It is a good name, though, isn't it? Sorry.
It's a really good name.
Thank you. Trying to think. It's a good Flash villain because it's all about sneakers. Anyway.
Oh,
We've got, okay, what do we do with these
tiny... It was just a bag and it's labeled Wednesday Club.
Okay, so I'm going to open a random piece of tissue paper here. All right, which is always what you should do. This is good, I need more...
What is this? What is this?
Oh my God. Okay, we're going to have to line them up on the little blue line here.
Is this me?
Thank you to David, by the way.
Oh my God. Oh my God!
Is this me because I'm taller than everyone else?
That is definitely.
And I have a mustache.
Oh, this was our supervillain, create a superhero party. You remember? Because you had
my God! This is so cool.
How did you find? Oh my God! It's a custom made mohawk for a Lego man.
Oh my God!
I'm so happy.
I'm taller than you guys. Oh, I love it so much. That is so fun.
And.
Oh, this is so cool.
Oh, that's for me.
That must be, and I'm also gonna remind you that this is great that it is in fact for Matt's
key.
It's Matt Key.
It's Matt's key.
It's a Matt Key. This if I were a hero, this would be my symbol now. Like just a. Of course, I guess that's like the escapist
thing.
You like
Matt Key, so I put a Matt Key on your Matt Key.
Yeah, and sort of like Matt Key's keys to fun, safe comic book reading with Matt Key. That's me. I'm Matt Key. That's awesome. Thank you. So, who is this from?
David.
David Oakes, you delightful scamp. These are
amazing. Thank you so much.
I love this. Is going straight to my office.
I have a Lego man with a mohawk. I'm quite pleased.
This is all right. Well, now he
to my hair.
You know he stands.
If you ever want to do that to your hair, I am ready to help. I have
right
people standing by to make that happen. I will
hair
get
people repel from the
thank you, David. That is fantastic.
So that sets off our. I probably should have put up the Daily Wednesday for that. But speaking of mail, as we get before we get into the rest of today's exciting Comic-Con wrap up and haul and highlights and discussion.
Good catch.
And I'm baffled to say this. We have a secret sponsor.
I don't know how that works.
I don't either.
Liz.
Liz did something to us.
Producer Liz, what have you done?
Sorry, you think it's a real emergency, but I'm just doing a bit. Liz?
Liz?
The secret envelope
says. The secret envelope. I want to be like Johnny Carson, Karnak style.
Oh, God, I'll be amazed. I'm curious how much of our chat actually knows what that is.
Hold it up here, I'll take it again.
Yeah.
Yep. Ooh, thank you.
All
welcome,
right.
Sal. Mm-hmm.
She's making a face, and I cannot actually tell why. But she seems pleased. She looks like she's gonna burst. Like you fed her some candy from the Wonka factory, and she's about to turn into a blueberry.
Oh my God, Matt, look at this.
No, you can't look at it, apparently.
Apparently I can't look at it, that's fine. that's fine, I will find out what this is at some point, but it's okay.
Who's our secret sponsor, Matt?
Do you want me to say?
See your face, we can take turns.
Well, why don't you start it off?
I would like to thank tonight's sponsor. Today's episode of the Wednesday Club is sponsored by the Taliesin Jaffe Fan Club. Check them out at http://taliesinjaffefanclub.net. The Taliesin Jaffe Fan Club is a little corner of the internet that started as a joke but became much more. Through our appreciation of the light and encouragement Taliesin has brought into everyone's lives, we also strive to do the same for each other and people in need. Much like ancient Egyptians, we like cats and pyramids. Unlike ancient Egyptians, we avoid the sun lest we burn alive because we're all gods here. And if you could show off this beautiful, beautiful image.
Oh
my God. Yeah, I know exactly what that image is.
The very essence.
I know exactly.
Of the Taliesin Jaffe. Look at, we have a corner bug for them. Oh my God.
This
thank
is,
you so much,
guys.
Taliesin Jaffe's official unofficial fan club.
The TJ fan club. TJFC.
Oh my God.
TJOUFC, which makes them sound like a European soccer team.
Abandon all hope.
All the rescue aid society.
Oh, this is so.
If you've ever, it is an amazing website. It is an absolutely amazing website. I highly recommend, I actually do highly recommend this website. It is, I quietly stalk it and am
look,
delighted by it.
It changes your mouse cursor and it leaves it is. Because it's vintage internet.
They found a, they found
my God.
GeoCities.
That's
and they
amazing.
Built,
there's,
there's also,
oh
there's
my God, this
the,
is
the
so
last
funny.
Time we checked the gallery, it was pretty spectacular. It was just pictures of roosters.
This is amazing.
Thank you guys so much. This is so ridiculous.
Oh my God.
And it's
so funny.
Hi.
So funny.
Yeah.
Under construction.
Oh,
that's
cats, pyramids.
Oh, they added some. That's added some stuff. There's the chickens.
Checks out.
Abraham kitten.
So that cat that says certified cool, this is a wonderful in-joke. I'd like to thank whoever did that. Because I think that is the certified cool cat that they use inside the Diamond Previews catalog to indicate, like, interesting stuff in the Diamond Previews catalog.
Wow. Man. Sounds like we got a nerd here, everybody.
It's me. I'm the nerd.
Nerd.
I love my Diamonds catalog.
Oh. Cat, dapper AF.
Yeah, that's a dapper
says
cat.
With a, she held up a sign just to make sure we said that. I love it.
I'm a little emotional. I'm gonna be okay. This is great. This is amazing. Okay, this is good. It's been a long weekend. It's been a very long weekend.
It has.
Thank you guys so much. Oh.
Nice font, by the way.
Yeah. Well done.
Well done.
Well done.
Well, thank
well
you.
Done, well, everybody.
Thank you to this week's sponsor, the Taliesin Jaffe unofficial. Fan club.
What's your favorite mispronunciation of your name?
Taliesin. It might be my favorite.
Taliesin.
Like the Taliesin fields?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was about to say, it sounds like a Greek, like, it was like next to the Acropolis or something like that. Like, hey, I'm going to the Taliesin.
There's the proper pronunciation, which is Taliesin, but that's the Welsh pronunciation, so I occasionally have to correct Welsh friends to stop saying it right. And then I have some British friends who say, like, I'm trying to remember who Taliesin, it gets weird in there, but it's like, and it's the thing. At first I thought it was just people messing up my, but I've got like six British friends who do it, and I think it's just a thing. I'm just like, it's cute. I like
Wizard rules. Who knew?
I know. Oh God.
So what are we here to talk about today?
Well, we all went on a sabbatical this weekend, and we went to,
A sabbatical.
It used to be called, I've heard different names of like code names of, how do you feel about, we're back at the Wednesday Club. What's San Diego Comic-Con? There we are.
What's a Comic-Con?
It's two different questions. San Diego Comic-Con is one of the largest and best known of the gatherings dedicated specifically to the comic book art form. Comic-Con San Diego specifically is now a pop culture festival celebrating a lot of different aspects of the stuff that we love. It recently turned 40 years old, so it's somewhere between 40 and 45, I think.
It's having a bit of a midlife crisis, I think. It bought a very expensive new car.
Well, thank God it didn't. It was going to.
Yeah,
it was going to ditch its city that loved it and go to some other shinier city, and it didn't, thank goodness.
Kept the station wagon. Very practical.
Just got a new station wagon.
Yeah, just got an upgrade. Yeah, just a little bit.
Spinning rims on that station wagon.
It is not the largest in the world. I think Angoulême and a couple of the Japanese conventions have that honor, but it is extremely large.
It's extremely large, and I think it's like
unique.
You can't undervalue its importance to the sort of proliferation of pop culture news and introductions and stuff like that. It's like, it's just south of LA, San Diego. Everyone loves to go there, so like,
And it is one of those amorphous things. I'm going to try not to say Burning Man too many times today, even though it's all I'm thinking about now.
Uh-huh. It's a month away.
Literally next week. You know that, right?
Yeah, Gen Con is just another obstacle at this point on the way to Burning Man.
Yeah, fair, fair.
Oh, God. Gen Con I can pack for in about 48 hours. I'm ruined otherwise. Mm. But there's much like Burning Man, though, there's always a lot of conversation about what is San Diego Comic-Con, what is it worth, what does it mean, why are we doing it?
How has it changed?
How
is
it changing? Is it changing for the best? Is it for the worst? Is it getting too big? Who's it for? And there's kind of this amorphous conversation that has been happening since I've been going to Comic-Con for like 15, 20 years, I don't know how long. And I feel like that conversation has been happening the entire time.
Yeah.
I believe there's never been a time that people weren't like, I should have brought it. I found the most wonderful, like, early 70s fanzine letter crankily complaining that Comic-Cons have been ruined.
What?
It was beautiful.
That is so good.
And I believe it was because that person was sort of like, it was like they're starting to like put comics in bags and charge more money for them. I think that was the like, it's not like it used to be.
All downhill from there.
Yeah. So there's never been a time where Comic-Cons haven't been being ruined.
I would love to see what that person said now.
Yeah. Comic-Con is the San Diego. When I say Comic-Con, I always mean San Diego. There are many Comic-Cons, but that's the one I'm thinking of.
That is the one.
I grew up idolizing, wanting to go to, and it certainly is a very different show than it used to be, but yeah. I love it very, very much.
I will say that, like, I have two different experiences on the show floor itself. And that is when you walk in, you're almost always, at least for me, I walk into the middle. That's just how it happens. I walk into the middle of the show floor. I'm in the middle of everything.
It's the San Diego Convention Center, and it now occupies the entire thing plus some.
Yeah, it's now like it's in surrounding hotels, and now it's taken up the entire gas lamp district. They have like halls A through H. It's all Comic-Con. And I typically find myself somehow every time walking into hall D.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, here I am in the middle of everything. And it's like you walk in and you're just like overwhelmed with giant statue of a Hulk and like a giant mech over here and then like this really cool setup with lights. It's just like, it's everything I love at once. But so I had that experience. But I find myself like in a very calming heart of Comic-Con when I find the section dedicated to the long boxes.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, I can breathe. Okay, let's...
That first
this
run is
meditation.
Like Gozer was like the form Gozer was chosen was pop culture. Like, she was the form of your distraction. You walk in and It can be a lot.
I feel like you're going to get a lot of hugs from me tonight, sir.
I know.
That's really funny.
Thank you.
This is it's funny. A lot. It's a lot of stimulus. It's a lot of crowds. It is not for everyone, but I do love it.
I do too. I get a lot out of it, and I know plenty of people, and I got a lot out of it back when I was a fan. I got a lot of it. I've been a dealer there. I used to work a booth there. I've been a panelist for the anime section back when the anime was just starting to like penetrate that reality. And then now I'm like in a very different reality.
Happy 30th birthday to Akira, by the way.
Oh my God!
It was like last.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my God, that's
the
awesome.
The movie version. I think the book is 35.
Yeah, book's a little older. At some point, we'll probably have to talk about that because that's an amazing story of how that came to the United States and the amazing people who brought it over here and brought it to the United States.
Oh, I'd love to hear that story.
Yeah, Alzi and Carl Masick and all the kids at Streamline Pictures who did such a good job of bringing it to the States. That's a whole conversation we can have.
It's a whole other episode.
That's an episode because I got to actually be there in some of the first theaters that it ever played in the United States.
Oh, and dear
actually
Lord.
Got to know the people who managed to bring it here. It was really fascinating. That'll be a whole episode. It's a whole thing. But you learn a lot about what, I mean, like I find that the internet is a poor barometer for tastes and trends. I feel like you get the tastes and trends a lot of the time. I think you get a better barometer of what people are excited for just sitting, watching the costumes go by,
Costumes are I want to use this word and I don't know if it's right. What is a bellwether?
I believe that's correct. I believe a bellwether is a and I could be right, is a thing that like collects data. Was an early, I think, oh God, I've got to double check now. Now I'm
something to give you.
I'll look it up.
Yeah. I don't know.
It's a weather balloon.
I have noticed that the things people dress as are often a good indication of like levels of love. The example I always go back to is I remember seeing the first anime convention where there was Avatar the Last Airbender cosplay. Mm-hmm. It was very, very early. And I was like, what is this? This random Nickelodeon show everyone's dressed at. That's so weird. And it's like, oh, because it was incredibly special.
Mm-hmm. Beacon, guiding light. A clue.
Yeah.
Guidebook, handbook.
Welcome
to the Wednesday Club where Matt Key reads the thesaurus.
Thank you.
He'll actually have to do a whole thesaurus episode now.
Yay, yeah. Words.
But it is, I mean, and you see the way the people are interacting with their fandom there, and you really get like this, like it's like getting into a tiny machine and going into a human body and getting to see how all the cells work. You're really, you're getting into the veins of pop culture, and sure, it's a giant consumerist nightmare on a certain level. Where it's like being inundated, like someone has redressed like some sort of Nightmare Apocalypse Vegas with all your favorite characters, like terrible Ready Player One LARP. But on the other end of that, though, because that is the nightmare end of Comic-Con, but on the other end of that, though, is really getting to see the baseline of people who are creative in the way that they interact with a popular culture, really figuring out what that's going to look like in the future. And they may not even know they're doing it, but I mean, I always love seeing what people are wearing, how people are expressing their fandom now. What are the things that people are getting excited about? What are the things that people are trying to turn their friends onto? And not just movies and TV. And I know that's a very flashy part of it. And then there's also all of this amazing installation art. I mean, there's all of these wonderful experiences that get put together. I only ever have time to maybe do one, but like. You can play around with so much ridiculous stuff that has only been designed to simply be enjoyed. Mm. And it is so specifically beyond any other purpose other than say, hey, there's this video game that we really like that's about it's Tomb Raider. So we're just going to make a giant pile of skulls that you get to play with. And that's it. We don't necessarily think this is going to sell anybody on buying Tomb Raider, but we're celebrating Tomb Raider with a pile of skulls.
Well, it's a celebration, but it's also like there is an element of awareness because like with social media the way it is now, it's like you put a giant pit of skulls out there and then people go and take pictures of it and they put it up online and everyone's like, where is this? It's the Tomb Raider installation. Oh, Tomb Raider. Oh, is there a new Tomb Raider? It's
serving a commercial purpose.
Yeah, it serves a commercial purpose.
Artistry and imagination,
yeah, exactly.
Dedicated to that at Comic-Con. And like your mileage may vary, but a lot of times there's really wonderful inventive stuff on display in service of these various things. Speaking of wonderful stuff.
Yeah. Oh, is it
show and tell time?
I don't know. Is it?
I think it might be.
Do you want to tell your really awesome story about what you said at the panel? Because
my highlight.
Your highlight, or is that
there were
too
so
much
many highlights?
With?
But I mean,
let's
like,
just do it now.
Let's just
now
go in.
Now imagine it.
You've got your little box.
I do.
What is that little box?
Oh, this is the box I mailed my badge in.
They mail you. Yeah, they mail you a box.
But it's nice and sturdy. So if you, let's say, really, really, really don't want to lose or mess up something, you might put it in this box.
I have several of these boxes. It's exactly what I use them for. They're such good boxes.
So I guess this is my, I'm going to be a jerk. I'm going to save it because it is the best thing that happened at Comic-Con.
All right.
And I will start with another of the best things that happened at Comic-Con. Because you all specifically need to know about this.
Well, if you've got everything in that. I now know where you got that purple bag now too.
So, are you ready? Because I was gonna say a quick thing.
Do it.
This is kind of a true. This is true, but
okay.
It's mixed in with other elements. I really have always wanted to go to Comic-Con for free. Like, since my first Comic-Con where I went as Jason Mewes' assistant, where I got to go for free.
Is that a thing?
Oh, I've got stories.
That's a man who needs.
I've got some great Jason Mewes, like, he's one of the just chillest, best dudes.
Oh.
Like, legitimately.
Oh.
Like, if we have time later, I'll tell the story of me, like, helping him with his, like, autograph line and everything. It's great. But I went for free. And then I was like, I had to pay.
Yeah.
And I was finally like, I shouldn't have to pay. I should be able to go for free. Like, I kind of work in this space a little bit, or like, I know this stuff enough.
Right. There are, Comic-Con does cost money. The badges in the last 10 years have gotten much more expensive as they tend to sell out faster and faster. But there is a subset of badges set aside for professionals in various industries. So for instance, I have a way of qualifying as a retailer, so I can go and pick out comics and do research, that is what Matt is talking about.
So
not just that, like
I legitimately
no,
like,
and it's a weird badge of honor when you finally get your badge because they want you to participate.
So I legitimately started doing comic book related journalism specifically so I could apply for press. But me doing that ended up getting me Marvel movie news, which has led me to being able to do this and like all these other things. So like part of my career was formed based purely on my desire to go to Comic-Con for free. And I say that because if you want to go to Comic-Con for free, start doing comic book press.
It may or may not work. Conditions are different every year.
But you can try.
It is a raffle.
It is a possibility. I did it. And so can you.
Okay.
Everyone wants to go to Comic-Con should go to Comic-Con.
Yeah. It's in the last 10 years. Once it started selling out, it hit that tipping point where, like, before it sold out, you could just drive down and go. But once it sells out, everybody knows they need to get their tickets early, and it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. And it has become increasingly difficult for folks who do not have a professional connection to go, which is a shame. But there's tons of cool offsite stuff you can do. This year there was Nerdist House.
Mm-hmm.
We had some panels. We had some fun. Really great.
Geek and Sundry had a takeover.
Yeah.
Right after our panel at Comic-Con.
We did, as usual, as we did last year, Taliesin's inspiration, which is the $2
challenge.
What's the $2 challenge?
The $2 challenge is something that that I started many, many years ago when I was trying to find interesting ways of having fun at the Ape Show, the Alternative Press Expo, back when I used to go to these things. I miss the Ape Show. I should really go back. Possibly very soon. This is also a thing started by a friend of mine named Joseph, who was really, really into paying for it with everything with $2 bills, because it was a delightful way of striking conversation with people. And
you're not wrong.
No, it's like it's people are interested and like immediately want to like connect with you when you do that, or they're really irritated by you because they don't have a drawer for this, and then immediately you know that you don't need to deal with those people. It's a good litmus test. So I would get $100 worth or 50 $2 bills, and I would go to the Ape Show, which is the Alternative Press Expo, where everything, to be fair, everything there is super, super cheap because it's all people just trying to sell comic books that are paper that have been stapled and folded by hand. So $100 goes a long way there. I would fill kind of one of those old doctor's bags full of comics, and about 70% of it would just be, whatever. And then You would get, though, that 30% would be stuff that you would never have heard of and you would have never found. And it was always delightful to have these amazing hidden gems. And some of them are from, like, ape shows I went to in, like, God, the 90s probably. And I still have these books that are that good. So I'm glad I can and kind of, like, pass it on to the two of you as well. And, like, it's a good way of...
It strikes a conversation at every booth I use them at.
Yeah.
And it helps to emphasize something that we love about Comic-Con, which is in addition to the very fun and creative installations and off-site experiences and all of this very, very imaginative but explicitly promotional stuff, you also have a lot of small and independent artists. Not as many as, like, you know, as maybe there used to be. I don't know if there's fewer in number or just...
I feel like it's safe to say they're fewer in number, but they're still there and they're still toiling in the fields of comic bookdom and they're...
And there's a section of San Diego called Artist Alley, and there's a section for small press. And
small press is becoming one of my favorite areas, too.
Small press is great.
Wonderful.
Red carpet.
And... So soft. One of the things that you can do there is find wonderful new projects to get excited about. And so this technically is before the $2 challenge because this was free. But I went to a lovely, lovely signing. And then I think I'll kick off show and tell here. For a book that you all need to know about. This is the free issue zero. The actual issue one will come out this fall. It is going to be monthly.
That was very signed.
Yeah.
Oh, very signed.
And I freaked these guys out on the panel by surprising them with Rolled and Told.
Look at this.
The indie comics RPG mashup magazine of your dreams. My dreams, more specifically. But you are all allowed to dream of it with me because it's real. This is being put out by Lion Forge Press. The editor is Christina Steens Stewart, a former Valkyrie and fantastic comic creator in her own right. And one of the wonderful things I'm going to show off, you've got custom adventures, custom maps.
Oh, I love, hey, look at that.
Yeah.
That's gonna come back.
This is going to come up later. But you've got descriptions of short adventures. You've got, short comics. Here's some sample characters.
I'm over here adjusting the camera.
Oh, yep.
That's cool.
Chief is adjusting the camera.
Just showing off pages
that are
not really for close-ups. They're just to give you an idea what's inside this thing. And when I went, Jen Vaughn and I made Steen sign, and she was like, I'm the editor. And I was just like, but it wouldn't exist without you.
I love that Amy is the one who gets the editor to sign the book.
That's, yep.
Well, come on.
That
sounds
so
like
on
we've
brand.
Got a nerd here.
It's so on brand.
What a
so
nerd.
On brand.
Look, I got a spooky guy on a skateboard.
It kind of the.
That's, it's a ghost. That's what a spooky guy's called.
Spooky guy. Yeah.
Spooky guy. I had a problem.
We all spooky ghost?
Well, I mean, like, we all become spooky guys in the end, don't we?
Maybe.
We all become spooky guys.
Spooky guys.
Spooky guys.
Look, you forged the adventure from Lion Forge. During the signing, if you got your zero free preview signed at Comic-Con, this wonderful artist who we will be returning to would draw your adventurer's untimely death.
And there you
are. Oh,
that is
choice.
Super funny.
So Blunderbuss is a character that I play in a home game, and has an untimely death, a tragic shambling mound accident. So I'm really excited to know how Blunderbuss will die.
The vibe I get from this book, and I only got to peek at it a little bit at Comic-Con, is very much kind of, it's almost, and tell me if this is not an appropriate metaphor, highlights for gamers.
It's like if Highlights and Dragon Magazine and Comic had a baby.
Yeah. It's got some fun stuff for you to play with. It's got a little bit of, and like that
It'll be a 64-page monthly magazine full of ready-to-play fun adventures, articles, and comics. The adventure begins September 2018. It is not like I wasn't already going to buy this. Thank you for giving me free stuff.
Zelevade, my level one wizard over here, is kind
they of gave it to everyone who paid. I'm not special. But I did get also these dice!
Oh, those
Ooh,
are so pretty.
Ooh, those are pretty.
Oh, and a bag.
So yeah, Rolled and Told, get excited. It's coming this fall. Talk to your shop about it because Lion Forge is a relatively small publisher. They're the ones who are doing the Voltron comics. They're doing some superhero books you might have heard of. But because they don't have the same presence as other folks, this might or might not already be on your shop's radar. And it obviously should be.
Hmm?
I mean, there aren't that many corners of the internet where I'm like, this is a slam dunk and you all need it, but it's this corner. This is that corner of the internet. You need this. You know you do.
I've got a slam dunk.
Yeah.
Here that I just cannot wait to talk about.
Mm-hmm. Please.
No. I'm not next.
That's a perfect segue.
I was not aware we were going in order.
No, I mean,
I guess we're going in order.
I don't necessarily need to dictate that. I just that's what we were
this,
doing.
This is a fun one. This was a critter who actually threw this at me. This was someone I got to meet early this week. It was Donald Souza, I want to say, and this was a book that he wrote and found actually an artist through the critter community and.
Critter comics.
It's a alternate history. What if magic and kind of D&D universe existed in this kind of a post World War II crime noir mystery,
cool.
Except with ogres and elves and wizards and people with bows, and it's very it's fun. It's got a really actually this is such a good cover. It really kind of gives you the vibe.
Beautiful.
It's a great book, and it's a small press book, and he just threw me two issues of it, and it was delightful, so I've just been really enjoying it.
So it's called Untold?
Untold.
That looks just wonderful.
Is that watercolor? What is that?
I don't know. It's gorgeous. It's not beautiful. I think it's
watercolor, yeah, but...
So this is just a fun read. I have no idea how one would find it, but it is great.
There might be a website or something in there. Hold on.
There's probably a website in there.
Mm. Probably so.
I was overly optimistic. Yep. Well, Google is your friend.
Yeah, it is.
very sorry.
All right, so
very early run.
Are you done?
I'm good. I've showed off.
So first of all, I want to apologize. I've not yet read this, but I wanted to bring it in as an example for our audience. So I believe that it was let me see the artists in here, the writers. Can't remember his name. So I was walking through just like I was no special area of the convention for press or anything like that. I was just out by the long boxes, just looking around for something. And there was a dude who was just like taking up one tiny corner of one of these booths. That's mm-hmm. all he had. And he was selling this book. And I walked by and he was like, hey there. Hey man, do you mind if I tell you about my book?
Aww.
And I was like, you know, yeah, I want to hear all about your book. And I can't 100% remember everything, but this is apparently based on a true story in Korea.
There's Korean and it's Korean signature at the bottom of that.
Yeah, okay. So it's based on a true story of like a past battles there, and he kickstarted it. And is just hustling and doing it all on his own. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to buy your book. I said, for no other reason, you are hustling hard. And I respect the hell out of you for that. Mm. Like, this is not an easy business. You wrote it. You have artists. You put it up on Kickstarter. You're at Comic-Con. This is probably not the only convention that you're at doing this.
Yeah.
And you're fucking doing it. And that's amazing. And I support you for doing that.
Art isn't easy.
So I pulled out like $10 and $2 bills because he only charged me like $5 for the first two, and then he threw in the other two. He's like,
aww.
I like what you said. Here's the other two for free. And I was like, you don't have to do that. Like, he's like, no, please. I want you to enjoy it. So I haven't read it. It might be the best thing I've ever read. It could be awful. I don't know. But the dude is hustling, and I respect that. So
fantastic.
First run.
You know, so there you go. There's that. If you know anything about that. But what I really want to get to, I've never read any of the Black Mask stuff, but I walked by the booth.
This is another small publisher who've been making big moves.
Big moves. So first I want to bring up this book, Cal Exit. I've only read this first issue.
How is it?
It's fucking fantastic.
Awesome.
Like, this is like, this book and the other book I'm going to get to in a second,
mm-hmm.
I now want to do an entire Black Mask episode, Black Mask Studios. I want to have every single writer and artist and editor they'll let us have.
Come visit us.
I want to meet with their editors because the storytelling that they're doing over there, at least between these two books, is incredible. And the artwork is great. It's inventive. It's inspiring. And it's like tackling some major issues. I feel like it's probably a liberal-leaning publishing company. I can't say that for certain. But its politics seem to be liberal leaning, so not like that. But
I will also say that I'm always a big fan. As somebody who lives in Los Angeles, anytime that they place
specifics,
I can show this.
Yeah, like anytime I'm like, I know that block, I know exactly where that's happening, and it's really well rendered, and like. I mean,
Matt, you missed us geeking out last week on Hawkeye and being like, this is exactly the storyline should involve an outdoor cinema festival because it's L.A. Like,
it's L.A., it should.
Like, I'm sitting here going, this is the, like in this little panel up here, I'm like, I know that theater, this is a theater, like, it's just a sliver of it right here.
Yep.
That's the El Capitan that's owned by Disney and it's right next to the Roosevelt.
And you like, can, and that's Hollywood Boulevard, and there's Hollywood a Captain Boulevard. America and a Wonder Woman cosplayer out there, like, taking pictures with tourists and stuff.
Wonderful.
And what's awesome about this, like, look at that. What's awesome about this,
I love it.
The elephant, the Egyptian and everything, is that they end up making that a metaphor for those three or four pages.
Oh,
like, not only do they use the landmark, they create a metaphor around it and comment on it.
Hmm.
And they use that to comment on the politics with the inherent politics of the book.
The story they're telling.
Yeah, which is very, like,
it's
pro-immigration and stuff like that.
It's very violent, I'll also say. It's very, very violent.
But here's what's kind of funny about this. The writer, Matteo Pizzolo, is married to an old friend of mine that I used to do sketch and improv with named Katie.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw her last year, I think, whenever CalExit was coming out, posting about, I'm so proud of my husband for writing this book. And it was like, wait. I've been hearing about this CalExit book. This CalExit book was written by your husband? I didn't even know he liked comics.
You just had like a girl next door Mary Jane Watson moment.
Yeah, I
just
really
like,
did.
What? You were trying to set me up with this girl for months. It was Mary Jane?
It was Mary Jane? You hit the jackpot, Tiger.
Yeah, you did, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, so like I had no idea. So I was like, why did I not know that your husband at the time was a giant lover of comic books? And I was like, I don't know. He did.
There's the guys you never talked about. I'm also going to have to make.
Oh, yeah. They're yeah, it's like, and he the character in the book modded it and everything. All right, so get CalExit. It is amazing. This, like, I've only read the first issue. For all I know, it goes off the rails, but I don't get the sense that it does.
The only caution I would give on this one is that the book has been coming out very slowly, so you have lots of time to catch up.
But it's great. There's a mystery to it. What's going on? Why? What has happened to California that it is now in the situation that it's in? Like, all that stuff. The book I loved this book, but I want, if I wasn't already married, I would marry this book.
Aww.
Like, this book just like speaks directly to my sensibility. This is the kind of book I want to be writing. No, I'm just like stopping. Okay. Like, I just want to talk. I'm just black. I'm just talking black math.
Okay. It's incredible. Like that, I believe Matthew Rosenberg wrote that, right?
Yeah, and I think he's writing Multiple Man.
Yeah.
He's been scooped up for many, many things. Wisely.
But this, it starts off with.
Oh wow.
Look at how this starts.
Yeah, that's great.
Look, it's like intro, like credits, a Boss and Rosenberg comic book with Thomas Mauer. Four kids walk into a bank.
Like, show art design, the pages. Like, they can't see it.
Okay. You're right.
I'm just saying.
So
bring enough to share with the class.
This is how it starts.
Class, I mean, all of you.
Like, look at that. Black Mass Studios. A Boss Rosenberg comic book with Thomas Mauer. Four kids walk into a bank. And then you get more credits there. Chapter one. As far back as lunchtime, always wanted to be a gangster.
Which is maybe a
then it goes
sentence.
Into the... Okay, so and then it starts
Dragon.
With a D&D campaign.
Yeah.
And you have... all of the main characters in the D&D campaign talking to each other, but they're kids. And they're arguing over the game because this is the first time they've ever played it and they don't understand it. And the dragon keeps correcting them because the dragon is the DM.
Yeah.
And it's just like, I'm like, that's the introduction? It's brilliant. And like the comedic voices are crisp and immediate. You immediately know who every single kid is. They have such a fun
Oh, the art
use.
Is sharp.
The art is sharp. The characterizations are sharp. They have such a fun use of the panels, of the art of comics. They use tiny little symbols to immediately associate.
It's got a bit of a Hawkeye vibe.
It really, it absolutely does. This is like, it has a lot of that vibe.
There's many wonderful Hawkeyes, but we're mostly probably, I'm guessing, all talking about the Matt Fraction, David Aja.
Matt Fraction,
David
Aja, yeah. Yes.
And there is violence in the book, but almost all of it happens in a clever way where you don't actually see it in the panel. So there'll be like a giant, like, it's even beyond like just a giant clang. It'll be like, kids should not do violent things like this. And then the next panel, you see the bloodied nose. And it's like, whoa, what happened? Oh, that's awesome. Like, just that one panel where it's just like, you don't get to see this. It's like, it's about four kids who decide to rob a bank for reasons that I'm not going to say. You should just go read the book. But honestly, like, I started reading. I was like, oh, this sounds like a fun book. I'll start reading this. And I was like, I can't stop reading this book. This is the best book ever. I legitimately cannot recommend it enough.
Amazing.
So... anyway, you haven't. What do you got?
Yeah. No. Just we're heading. Your turn.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, we're heading back to you.
Okay. Let's see.
I'm a little thin because I forgot half my stuff at home. Oh my gosh. That's why you don't put it into two bags.
I brought too much stuff.
Thank
you. You know what? I'm gonna do this now.
Yeah, you are.
Because just in case, so we don't run out of time. I aspire to friendship level ups based on knowing you two. Because you are so thoughtful and wonderful all the time. So, Matt?
Yes.
Oh, no.
Oh, what have you done?
Do you have these?
No.
Wow, what a
These are
fun.
Beautiful. Woo.
Shade that's
changing. Oh, my
changing.
God. These are gorgeous.
Oh, man. That is a... Wow.
I have not opened it to check, but that should be... the complete run of Steve Ditko's Shade the Changing Man.
Oh my God, are you serious?
It only went 8 issues.
Oh my God, I mean, of course it did. It's a
it
weird book.
It got caught in like the DC implosion, I think.
Oh, this is awesome. Good find.
It is a fabulous classic DC character though, Shade the Changing Man.
Yeah.
It's become like Shade the Changing Girl, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm. Well, and this was right before it got picked up by Vertigo and made even weirder. Like, this was the Shade the Changing Man that eventually was picked up.
This was, I think there's a few decades in the middle, but...
Oh, yeah.
I do think, like, given that one is Ditko, one is 90s Vertigo, and one is, like, weird women taking over comics,
yeah.
I feel like our whole
yeah.
show is just...
That's,
that's
Cecil's book, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
God, the full power
of that on the Young Animal episode because she writes Shade the Changing Girl, which is now Shade the Changing Woman.
The full power of the M-Vest is unknown, and although it could destroy mankind, I must use it to save my life.
Wow.
The Madness Vest. It is good stuff.
Oh, so good. That is so awesome. So, good find.
No, but that's yours.
Wait,
do you
what?
Not realize this is
no.
a present for you?
No. Are you serious?
That's why I asked if you have it.
No. That's so nice.
This shade.
Oh, my God. This...
She's trying to give you
that's
shade,
That's the nicest
Matt.
Shade I've ever received.
Sorry.
Oh, my God. Amy,
yeah.
Thank you so much.
No, I thought you should have it because it's 8 issues of Ditko.
That is so nice.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
We're all definitely
so
more
nice
teary than normal.
Last year. We're great at stuff and talking.
Yeah.
We'll have to do this when we do our Ditko tribute. We'll have to pull this in.
You have to tell us how it is.
I absolutely will. I'll bring
Very
it.
Excited.
I'll bring it with me to Gen Con.
Yay!
This is, thank you. I'm blown away by your kindness. That's so nice. Thank you. Oh, I can't wait to get into this. I'll probably read this tonight.
Yeah, let me know. I'm very excited.
Oh, this is so fun. Thank you, Amy. That's,
oh, you're so
aw.
And,
I love you.
Okay.
Bacon support. Internet sensation Amy Dallen strikes again. You're not wrong.
okay. This is sort of a weird one. But I got you this fun collection.
What on earth is
Mostly
this?
Mostly because it contains this story, which you should just take out and fold out the cover of... And I think you'll figure it out.
What the what is this?
This is a comic I remember well, and I don't know if you've ever read, but I thought you should have
in
your collection.
I mean, like, I must have, because I was alive and reading everything
back then. So pull out all the parts of that cover. It's part of the X-Men Road Tripping Collection.
What?
Oh, my God.
No. No. Oh, my God. What the? Can I? Oh, I can't. I mean, what the fuck? Holy shit. I can't even. I mean. Okay.
Oh, that's
I'm
so cool.
This around. how? What fucking witchcraft is this?
Because sometimes circa the year 1998, this is how I found out that that existed.
So somehow I've gone this entire time without knowing that there's an issue of X-Force where they go to Burning Man.
Technically, they go to, let me see, the Exploding Colossal Man Shindig and Hullabaloo.
Oh, my. Who wrote this?
I should know.
It should say on the cover.
Alan Moore.
No. Hold on.
Different Moore. Adam Polina drew it, I think.
Here we go.
John Francis Moore. Adam Polina.
I wonder if they go to Burning Man. Like, if they, like.
I mean, like, look at this. Holy shit.
I haven't reread it in so long.
Oh, my God. It's down.
Oh, my God. The man's. Oh, they're rigging it.
They're raising it.
This is.
This is a 10
so
city.
Amazing. Ah! Oh, my God.
This will be us in like 4 weeks.
Oh, no.
Oh, God. 4 weeks.
No.
5 weeks?
Not yet.
Is it five?
Don't think about it. Oh, my God. This is crazy.
It just seems like something you should own.
This is so. Hey, I can do that. Holy cow. I mean, wow. How?
Oh,
the fact
God.
That you remember that this existed is so insane.
Oh my God. That's genius.
Who's on the team? I want to see who in the team goes here because it's like, it's that weird X-Force. Tabitha, when she was Meltdown as opposed to Boom Boom.
Oh, instead of Boom Boom, yeah.
Sunspot, of course. He goes, obviously.
Of course he does.
Warpath, who only goes because he's invited. Siren, who is goes but doesn't tell anybody. And there's a Danny Moonstar in there who's just not even, doesn't even have a super name because she's too cool for that.
Yeah.
Danny
Moonstar would be good at Burning Man.
Yeah, oh, yeah, very much. Danny would work Burning
Man. Yeah, Danny would be great for Burning Man.
Sunspot's got the most irritating camp, though.
Oh, yeah. He's got
the plug and plug and play.
He's got the plug and play.
Oh,
what does
man.
That mean?
So
I know that there are camps, but what is a plug and play? Why is his annoying?
This is kind of getting into some Burning Man politics.
Burning Man lore, I can do this. And by the way, we are going to still do our 5-minute topic, so feel free to submit your questions for your 5-minute topic.
Oh, and because I may not have said this, this is a present for you. Sorry.
I'm so excited.
Oh my God, amazing.
Camps are basically groups of people who share resources in order to like exist more comfortably at Burning Man, and sometimes people like Google decide to share resources, and it's like, this seems like a bit much, children. So he seems like one of those people who's like, I bought a 747, chopped off the wings, and we're living in it, and the top floor is a party. And you're like,
because he comes for money, he might come at it with enthusiasm rather than a camping spirit. Might go over.
And in the spirit of Burning Man, we a lot of us consider that to be, and both ironically and unironically, a little cringy. So everyone just kind of does the.
Yeah, it's like, I mean, if I had the resources, I probably would too, but still, bro, like, it's just like, yeah.
And you're that guy. And you're like, some days you're that guy. There's an in-out. We should actually bring the in-out list at when we come back.
I ran into Adrian at Comic-Con twice, DJ Adrian.
I saw that you ran into our favorite DJ.
Mashup DJ. Yeah.
So I think that's in there with a bunch of, they're just organized around the principle of the X-Men doing fun stuff and taking trips. It's just a weird collection from the early days
this
of paperbacks called
All Rules the Trippin. Adventures of Team Mutants of Generation X as they careen through the wilds. Oh my God, okay, I'm already, you have me at Gen X. Have me at Gen X.
Vexel Ghost asks, would Johnny Storm ruin Burning Man?
No, he would weirdly, I think, be the best burner.
Yeah.
Is it my imagination that, I think he is the right amount of, like, both innocent, childlike, and obnoxious that it kind of is the entire Burning Man.
Well, yeah, and, like, he would shoot, he would be able to take the heat really well.
Yeah.
Because he's always on fire anyway. Yeah. Bless you. But he could also, like, fly up and, like, make crazy designs.
Oh, like, at night, and that'd be great.
Yeah. All, like, 75,000 participants would be like, woo!
You could be doing laughs. Yeah. It'd be great.
Yay! Okay, so that was my turn.
Okay, I'm just going to show. So I was actually, I was in Artist Alley, and this is something I picked up for Artist Alley, which is great because all of these people, bless you, that was a fabulous sneeze. Artist Alley is always fascinating because it's just such a treasure trove of talent and different people doing different things. And I came across this piece. I didn't even look to see who was drawing it at first. It was just, it immediately grabbed me as something that I needed. And then it turned out that it was actually somebody I knew for many, many years who had drawn it. My friend Celine Chappas, who did this wonderful Crying Doves.
Whoa.
Look at how spectacular that is.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow.
Yeah. I'm just, it's...
Oh, that's beautiful.
The Purple Rain Tour was one of the first concerts I ever went to. So
really?
I really, really, yeah.
Wow.
This is probably going to end up as a gift for a friend, but I'm very, very excited. I've got to bring the rest of my stuff, but it is an amazing...
Talis is mad because he left some of his haul at home.
I did. I left. I put it in two bags instead of one, like some sort of chump. So
we shall have to have spillover.
So
I'm going to throw this out there because I think it's great.
Yeah, yeah.
I got the free preview of the comics.
Oh, yeah. I think I've got.
No one is. This is not a sponsored episode, but damn it, there aren't exciting stuff.
I haven't even looked through it.
Yeah.
Just yet. I brought it to show off just in case.
I'm particularly looking forward to. Oh God. How great does that look?
Oh, gorgeous.
Yeah, we're gonna have to get back together with Comixology at some point.
Hit Reblog is in here, and I haven't had a chance to read it yet, but it's like talking to the creators of comics that went viral about what happened and what that was like, which is the coolest idea. So anyway, thanks, Comixology Originals.
So,
this is awesome.
First of all, how about this?
Yeah!
You guys want to talk about that real fast? Like, Jody Hauser, who, by the way, in chat, after I told my I wanted to do press so I could get into Comic-Con story, she said that she continued doing her webcomics long enough just to make sure she got into Comic-Con as a pro. So Hauser and me, same page.
Yep. So our friend Jody Hauser was all over Comic-Con, and it was very exciting.
Including our panel where she trolled us and then promptly left.
Lovingly.
She is the troll ultimate.
She had literally a panel conflict and made it to our panel to
ask
the question.
It was so lovely.
She is the dearest. And she, like, if you didn't see her signing line when she was doing the signings for the free previews or for the previews of the Stranger Things comic she is writing,
Stranger Things.
Around the corner.
Amazing.
It was amazing.
I'm so proud.
We will never get to talk to our
Jody Hauser, I'm so proud of you.
Yeah.
I think we're all very proud of you.
Like, it's so good. I'm so excited.
Please give up your relentless war against us due to all this praise.
We surrender.
We don't even know why there's a war against us, except that you just like really like to fight, I guess.
It's been going on so long, who can remember anymore? Generations have passed.
The long, long ago. I came across the University of Dundee, who is now offering comics and graphic novel masters. I know nothing about it, but if you're in that area and you want to get a master's degree in graphic novels or comic books, University of Dundee, go do it.
Which reminds me of the amazingness of librarians, which reminds me of the now Eisner-winning short story. Those who watched last week's episode may remember that we went over the short story nominees at the Eisners, and one of them was for a short biography of a wonderful woman named Karen Green, who is a librarian at Columbia University in the Rare Book Archive, who single-handedly turned their collection from 3 graphic novels to, I think, 14,000.
Oh, my God.
And has just, it's called A Life in Comics, this short comic. And it won. It's written and drawn by Nick Susanis, a really fascinating figure. He did his PhD in the form of a comic. It's called Unflattening, and I really, really need to read it. It's just incredible stuff. Anyway.
What's his PhD actually on? Do you know? Is it about?
I think it's about comics and how they work, but he did it in the form of a comic deconstructing, like, how
comics similar
work.
To, like, Scott McCloud's book?
Sort of, yeah.
Yeah? Wow.
But, you know.
If you're watching our show, send us that dissertation.
You never know.
Boy, we never know these days.
So that leads to, like, one of my other highlights was the Eisner Awards. Did you know anyone with a badge can go to the Eisners?
Amazing.
I knew, but literally only because you told me.
It was an absolutely singular pleasure this year. I talked to at least 2 people, and I think we had some more hands at the panel, who told me they literally only were at the Eisners because I had told them on the internet that it is possible to go to the Eisners.
You are an award show pusher. You are a pusher of award shows.
Nerd. You're such a nerd.
I was in the room the year Karen Berger got inducted into the Hall of Fame. It was last Friday. She got up and she gave a speech. Karen Berger is a legendary editor.
Maybe one of the most important editors
on a short
history.
List of the most important people to ever work in comics, as far as I'm concerned. She is the founding editor of Vertigo Comics. In her speech, she said she had to thank a few people, and those people were Alan Moore, Peter Milligan, I'm forgetting one of the names, Neil Gaiman and Grant Morrison.
Yeah.
You know, just a couple people that she helped give a start to.
Who are those people again?
We'll do an episode. Have they?
It's a comics thing.
Okay, yeah, I don't get comics.
Because those are writers that she worked with very early in their careers, and she says, you know, she was like, I would be nothing without them, and it's like, the common ingredient is you. In addition, I also, wild cheering, the Hall of Fame induction we'd been waiting for literally for years. Every year she was on the list of nominees, and every year she didn't get inducted.
One of the richest women in the world, one of the greatest comic book artists and legends, been working nonstop since 1977.
Who's in the Hall of Fame?
Rumiko Takahashi.
Woo! Sorry about the microphone, it's about
one of the
time.
Greats. One of the greats, the world has ever seen, and she's been writing some of the best manga that Japan has ever seen for decades now.
Yep. She's like beyond a legend. This was the year she got inducted, along with just there is so much amazing comics history that you can learn from attending that ceremony, from being at Con. Mm-hmm. I learned about a direct market figure named Carol Kalish, who was massively important, and unfortunately we lost very young, and got to hear Paul Dini struggle emotionally through the speech, a tribute to his friend, who unfortunately died very young. But in the early 90s, the direct market was like in the process of being born in the late 80s, early 90s. I guess it comes from the late 70s, but like it was still establishing itself. And one of those key steps, like Carol literally had the idea to start a program to help comic book stores buy cash registers, because they would all be able to do more and better business, but none of them could afford cash registers. And she was like, here, let's work something out. I think she worked for Marvel at the time, and she was like their outreach person.
Wow.
And she literally got a program started so comic book stores could buy cash registers, because they were all inventing it together, and it was so small and disorganized. And like, she was just three steps ahead of the like, we can make this more professional. It will pay off. I promise, this is gonna work. And she unfortunately passed away at the age of 36 in 1992.
Whoa.
He told this wonderful story. He said she could talk anyone into anything. The first time he met her, I think he said it was in Chicago, I'm not sure, but he definitely said it was a blizzard, and she talked him into walking a mile to get ice cream. She sounds like an amazing woman.
That's impressive.
Whoa.
Pushing for comics, pushing for comics to be a thing, pushing for them to get into the hands of the people who wanted them, and would have gone on to do great things and gotten inducted into the Hall of Fame, along with Jackie Orms, the first African-American female cartoonist to have a nationally syndicated strip. She wrote about ordinary life. She wrote about politics. She wrote fun, frivolous things. She wrote about The struggle against, I had never heard of the double V symbol, which apparently symbolized victory against both, in World War II, symbolized victory in the war against fascism abroad and racism at home.
Oh, I know that.
There was a wonderful speech given by her, I think, grand niece, who was thanking both the woman who wrote a recent book, Nancy Goldstein, on Jackie Orms to help raise her profile and rediscover her, and gave a shout out to the upcoming generations of creators, to like the artist Afua Richardson she mentioned, and Spike Trotman, who you all know I am just in awe of as an editor and publisher and raconteur. And the Eisners in general were spectacular. Their highest honors went to Emil Ferris's My Favorite Thing Is Monsters.
Mm-hmm.
And
really need to get that book.
You're gonna love it.
And well, you brought it in and showed it to us.
Yeah.
And it looks incredible.
It's incredible. Yeah. So several award wins for Emil Ferris and for My Favorite Thing Is Monsters, and several award wins, including, which we didn't realize until the next day, somebody pointed out to her, she checked the math and then she tweeted. There was I don't know if this has ever happened in the time I've been going. There was a tie in one of the competitive categories. I guess I've seen a tie for best newcomer before, but I had never seen a tie for best writer. That was ridiculous.
I mean, that's a big one.
Tom King won best writer. He's the writer of Batman and a lot of other wonderful stuff, and has been just absolutely
achieving Mr. Miracle is
quickly.
Blowing my mind.
Mr. Miracle
is
amazing, very good things about the Batman Elmer Fudd crossover. Yes, that is a thing.
Oh, one of the best moments in the entire Eisners was when presenter Nichelle Nichols which I have a photo in there. We can pull it up
here.
Of Phil Lamar and Nichelle Nichols presenting at the Eisners. When she came on, there was a massive standing ovation.
Of course there was.
Because
she deserves that.
But hearing her read the list of nominations and be like, nominated for Batman and Batman Elmer Fudd? Because she's just like, wait, am I reading that correctly?
Is this correct?
So we
should have Phil Lamar back on the show sometime.
Oh, yeah, we'll have
him. I love that guy.
He did an amazing job.
All right, great. Producer Liz says we'll do it.
We have a... Okay, sorry for the photo quality. That's me in the audience just getting excited because Nichelle Nichols is there.
There she is. There we are. Look at that.
Looking glorious.
It weirdly looks like Nichelle Nichols is on MST3K right now, but I'm cool with that as well.
So that was amazing.
So funny.
But the other winner of Best Writer was, as it turns out, the first woman to ever win that award, Marjorie Liu.
Also very well deserved. Monstrous is incredible.
And I have a picture because they won several awards for Monstrous this year. It was a monster sweep across the board. I keep saying that like Zach's gonna have the picture, but I didn't load them up properly. Sorry. So it's here.
It's doing the
It's recording my words.
Yeah, here.
It's trying to type.
There we are.
Thank you. Okay, so I have one more.
You can swipe if you want.
Thank you. First I'm just going to show this one because it's fun. Every year they show this picture of Jack Kirby and his wife Roz dancing, and every year it is the best thing ever. there we go. If we can get a close-up.
If we can get it.
Excellent.
Yeah. Aww.
they're just sort of patron saints of Comic-Con. So Marjorie Liu kept going up to accept awards on behalf of herself and of the artist Sana Takeda, who's the co-creator and a huge part of Monstrous.
Was also up for Best Artist as
mm-hmm.
well.
But who lives in Japan. So they won several awards, and she kept trying to get Sana on FaceTime until finally they won one of the best, I think, best ongoing series. And she finally got Sana on FaceTime and shared.
Oh my God, that's so cool.
With all of us at the Eisner Awards. She's like 3 or 4 awards deep at this point, just being like running out of things to say, making us all cry. She gave a wonderful tribute to the inspiration she draws from her grandparents who lived through some shit.
Yeah.
A tribute to survivors and to the things that she learned from them. If I heard correctly, which I hope I did, this was right at the top of the night, and when Nichelle Nichols called her up for the second time, I believe she said, "It's the woman who made me cry before," which is a heck of an honor. It's a little bit unfair. The writers give really good speeches. But everybody gives really good speeches at the Eisners. I could do an entire 2 hours just on that. We don't have 2 hours. we do have 2 hours, but they're not just
they're not
for me
just
to talk
for,
about
just
the Eisners.
The Eisners. We are, and it would be another 2 hours as well.
Yeah.
We just took 2 hours.
By the way, real quick,
which I'm always for.
If I may interrupt, I saw on your tag there, you've got that Wednesday-Z badge that a fan made.
Nigh. Yep, there you go.
I'm leaning into the close-up.
I have to apologize. I forgot my denim jacket at home, but on it, I have a Mary Marvel Marching Society pin that he made for me. And it just like, he was at our panel and he was so nice.
I met him at the Alpha event. He was very, very kind.
Very kind.
And I really appreciate it.
And made a giant bag of those. And you had the foresight to make Wednesday Club patches.
I did.
And hand them out. So that was super fun.
And now I have to make more.
Yeah.
Because they went way too quick.
Yeah.
I was that'll be enough.
And my lovely wife was kind enough to hand those out.
And then she was like, you didn't make enough.
We didn't have enough. Sorry.
Okay. I've learned my lesson.
Yep.
There will be more. They are not a limited run.
So that was, we'll call the Eisners my turn. Whose turn?
Okay.
Do I want to go? You know what? This is too light of a thing, which is mostly I often will like pick up stuff that I need to refill my shelf with. I specifically now only get hardcovers or collections of stuff that I'm planning on lending to people. So these things are almost
indestructible.
They're almost the opposite. It's actually this is a book I expect that within a year I will not own again. Because I will have lent it to someone and they will have moved.
Yeah.
which is what it's for. And this is a nice, I just picked this up. This was a little, and I think I'd already had one at one point, but this was just such an easy pickup to restock my Grant Morrison minis from the Vertigo days. This is a collection of 2 different books by Grant Morrison.
Hold on. Just because it amuses me.
Yeah. kill your boyfriend, which is the first story in here, is one of my. It's a weird favorite from the 90s.
I wanted to see if the executive editor's name is on these.
Oh, yep. Should be.
Keep talking. So, describe Kill Your Boyfriend.
Kill Your Boyfriend is a it was kind of a natural born killers before that sort of story was kind of it was one of the original stories of teenage love slash murder spree. Mm-hmm. And kind of it's a not particularly deeply disguised modern retelling of the Dionysian myth. This girl kind of teenage girl is kind of living a very static life that she's not particularly enthralled with, and is starting to like get the sense that and she's definitely the narrator of the story that things are on an inevitable path of dullness, and then this insane kind of British homeless hooligan shows up, gets her drunk, and decides that when they start breaking cars and just being destructive and kind of in a very Dionysian way, like, convinces her that what she really needs to do is shoot her boyfriend, her current boyfriend, and then leave with him on a mad murder and destruction spree across the UK until it ends sort of inevitably how these sort of things have to end. It has an interesting twist, and it's definitely an interesting look at that myth, which I really enjoy and is very very intense, a lot of fun, definitely a little dated, but still great. Vidarama is the other one, which is a very interesting. It's a young man who is going into an arranged marriage that he's not particularly thrilled about. But instead of that going down, instead he is kind of thrust into this apocalypse event, war between light and darkness, set in kind of a weird Cthulhu reality, as he is trying to come up with deal with the arranged marriage that his parents have set him into. It's a fun story, a lot of fun.
Editor's original series, Art Young, Karen Berger.
There you go.
Yep.
Continue.
It's undeniable. So this is like something that if you come to my house and I will especially irritate my young friends with these books.
Also, Philip Bond's art on Kill Your Boyfriend
is. I actually there's a panel that's actually one of the panels that is in. I have like 100 images in my laptop that are backgrounds that I shuffle through, and there's one that this panel is actually a panel that's one of my backgrounds that just pops up occasionally. She talks to the reader a lot. The main character talks to the reader and kind of narrates her experience, kind of going through this rebellious phase. And at one point, she's trapped on a tower with a gun, and she says, "I could still walk away from this. I could say I was kidnapped. I could say I was forced to do things. I'm at an impressionable age. I haven't killed anyone." And then it's just that moment of where it's going to go from there. Such a good piece. Beautiful art. A great old timey read. I'm from the bygone days of the 90s. Mm-hmm. I believe we're over to you, and I'll set up my.
So I had to go by the Marvel Strike Force booth. And talk to them. And they have a comic for their game.
Yeah. And,
no one here is addicted to.
Yeah,
nope,
no
one here has a problem.
Nope. None of us have a problem. And I found out from their, I believe it was one of their community managers, that there's a lot of Geek and Sundry fans over at Fox Next. Aww. So, like, you might be watching our show. We hope that you are. But, yeah, great comic. Fantastic game. Also, I got this from Alternative Press. It's Guns a-Blazin'. I've only had the chance to read the first.
Chief's note, I'm playing it right now. We see you,
we,
Chief.
We know, Chief.
So I've only had the chance to read the first issue, but it's a time travel romp where these two guys just really love the cowboy aesthetic, and they're traveling through time, and they shoot up dinosaurs. And
cool.
That you find him in the Old West, and it's just really fun. But here's what's fun about it. It's written by a dude who owns the comic bug down by the airport.
Nice. Oh, wow.
And he was like, "Here's a card." And I was like, "Wait, so when my lovely wife, Brittany, take a drink of water, stay
Yay.
Hydrated, worked at Wizard World, she and her friends that she worked with would go to comic bug. So I've been in that shop multiple Aww. Times. So to see the shop on, I was like, "I recognize this dude. Oh, he's got a comic. I'm going to buy it." And then he's like, "Yeah, comic." I was like, That's how I know this guy.
That reminds me.
No, I know this guy.
That reminds me of my favorite dumb radio play I used to listen to when I was a kid, Time Travel with an Uzi.
What?
It was about a time traveler who could time travel anywhere for like 2 minutes, and he couldn't bring anything, not clothes or anything, other than the Uzi.
Oh my God.
And every episode would just been him showing up, and then people show up that are like threatening him, like, oh God, it's dinosaurs. Good thing I have the Uzi. And it's just the sound effect of
so
shooting
silly.
The I'm out of bullets. Oh no, what do I have? And then he comes back. And
come back. Yeah.
That's the same joke over and over again.
So, again, just like this weird, like, sort of like serendipitous, like, oh, hey. You're selling a comic, and I know you, and that's really awesome.
Let's
so I'm going to support you.
Really quickly.
That's actually a good segue to one of my tent.
I like a cowboy outfit.
Purposes.
Yeah, it's a cool outfit.
Purchases.
My God, look at that. There's a giant ogre in there. I'm sorry. There's just.
Nice. Oh, yeah. That's another thing. Thank you for pointing that out.
That's got a vibe right there.
It's Old West, cowboys, time travel, and D&D all crammed together.
Yeah, nice. I was about to say, it needs a T-Rex. I'm like, okay, good, we got a T-Rex. That's cool.
Yeah, then it like goes into Khazar territory.
I got a whole thing about Khazar and the Savage Land.
Yeah.
All right.
So, yeah, super fun.
So, speaking of locals, a wonderful local outfit called Fanbase Press. They used to be called Fanboy Comics, but they have changed their name. I like the new name a lot. And I like what they're doing, which is that in addition to doing news and comics coverage, they are publishing. And one of the books they publish was nominated for an Eisner. I already own it, so I didn't buy it at Con, but I did buy this beautiful pin.
Ooh.
It's called Quince. It is the story of a girl who gets powers on her quinceañera, but
that's
she'll
cool.
only have them for a year. And it's adorable, Ooh. And it's wonderful, and it's sad.
Oh, that's cool.
And you should check out Quince. And this little cutie right here. I'm really proud of them. I know the Brian and Barbara are really cool people doing really cool stuff. It's super exciting that they were Eisner nominated this year. And I love my pin.
Fluffy Butt asks, is Marvel Strike Force a game? It's a mobile app game on your phone. Yeah.
Where did the thing go?
What you looking for?
For pictures.
It's behind
the iPad.
Me.
What do you call the thing for the technology?
What do you call the thing for the thing?
Here, what? Here.
We were originally under orders to get pictures of what we spent our $2 on. So here's
the best laid plans.
Me getting my pin for Quince, from Fanbase Press with Barbara, right there over in small press.
I ran by.
I made
there.
Her hold up the like Eisner nominated thing because I was excited and proud. Yeah.
Such a nerd.
Look at me fulfilling the homework.
Yeah. What a nerd.
And getting the homework cool done.
And buying things in $2 bills.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Shing. She's the best.
That's where I'm going.
Should we?
Next.
Okay, do it.
It's time for Shing. Oh, so
should we have a sawdust bear off?
It's time to have a sawdust bear off.
I never found her booth. I looked all over alternate press and independent press, and I never found
the
it.
The numbering was weird.
The numbering was weird. There's a little chunk of creators that tend to get pushed against the wall. What I call Oceanside.
Fair.
I know to look there just because I'm used to this. So Shane, this is okay. You've already gotten a couple of the ones that I'm very excited about. It's one of the great things about doing this with friends is that you get your friends to start reading like the weird books that you enjoy. And so I'm so glad that I've especially addicted you to this.
Yeah, I had seen some of her stuff online, but Taliesin sort of was like, put her solidly, put the pieces together for me, and I was like, you are all the things.
She's a delightful human. And she's an intoxicating, delightiful, and one of the most talented humans I've ever met.
Horrifically talented. It's like disgusting.
She tried to stop us.
Yeah.
Like, she was like, but you, I think Taliesin already got that, like we were going to... like be wasting the show's resources, and I was like, yeah, but that's his and this one's mine.
I want this for me.
So let's start with Shop Class.
Okay.
I've been looking
forward. Because I haven't gotten to read these all yet.
Oh man.
I just got them back.
So Shop Class I've actually been looking forward to for a while now because she said this was like an idea that she was gonna get to eventually and then put out a little postcard for it. I'm like, this is the greatest thing ever.
So she is a comics artist who is also an installation and sculpture artist,
she's
basically?
A sculptor and she's an installation artist as well.
She had one of the most beautiful booths you will ever see.
That she made herself. She did.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah, she's hyper, like, it's impossible how talented she is.
She was, yeah, it was.
That's not right. She's like Da Vinci.
Yeah, it's amazing. And the stuff she builds is truly spectacular.
I don't know how to open it.
Here.
And by the way, like, it sounds hyperbolic. It's not.
It's not.
She's,
no.
Like, if you could walk into one of her installations, yeah. It's you're transported to an entirely other world.
You can kind of see the booth build that, yeah, that wonderful traveling salesman case that she made.
And her little shingle, she actually had a shingle hung out.
There, look at that.
You can follow her at Sawdust Bear. One of the best things about the entire convention to me was the fact that I went after the panel to make my like third trip to see her, and she said that she had met several of y'all coming from the panel.
Oh, fantastic!
Best thing I ever heard.
That is so good to hear.
Because here is me. I'm just getting this out of the way.
Oh yeah,
don't forget it.
Just do it. You're right there. Go back.
Where?
I think you just saw it. Nope, never mind.
One.
All the way to the beginning then.
Which picture of us and Sawdust?
Oh, there we go.
There we go. This was me again fulfilling the terms of my $2 bargain. And minimizing the thing.
There we go.
Thank you.
You're welcome. That's what I do. There we are.
Excellent. So that's
This is you buying the comic book I want to bring up first, which is Shop Class.
What's Shop Class?
Shop Class is an illustrated guide. It's the beginning. It's the first issue of an illustrated guide showing how to use tools. And it is literally, it's just, and I want to say it's a beginner's guide, except it's not. It's a completionist guide. It's the parts of a screw. And it's an illustrated guide showing how a screw works and the different types of heads and what they're called. All the different parts of a cordless drill. Clamps and like how clamps and how wood glue works, and it sounds. This is one of those things that is someone who is technically competent, but not competent. I can get something done, but I don't have the technical know-how. This is just such a great guide to these basic understanding how torque works, how that little the rotational torque works on a cordless drill. Drive guides, pilot holes, why pilot holes work, how they use and how you use them and why you use them. And this is just like, it's just a wonderful, different, she has like in the very back, bits that make holes. And it's just, this is what all of these do and how you use them. And then a little extra area for shop notes. I have been looking forward, and I'm looking forward to more because she is has an amazing tool collection. So I'm like very excited with that.
Well, and, I don't know if this is like patronizing or not. I don't know if I'm even using the right word, but I think it's amazing that a woman made a tool book and it's women in the, like, it's like.
You're happy to see that out there in the world? Where
yeah, you know what I'm saying? Because it's like, it's so like, tools are a man's thing. You get a, it's Father's Day, your boy some tools. It's like, no, women.
Having
women,
the evidence that
yeah.
many
yeah, exactly,
are
exactly,
in
yeah, like,
tools.
Well,
yeah.
It's also it's nice to share because we've had a decade of watching her outbuild us on everything. So
oh my God, she's the most talented friend we had, like just hands down, just frighteningly talented.
It was just the day she showed up with the Barbie Dream Welder, and I was like, oh no, that's a whole nother story. Another one of hers that she put out is called "Say It With Noodles," and it made me cry.
I haven't seen "Say It With Noodles."
"Say It With Noodles" is a story about communicating through cooking. And it is it made me tear up. I'm to be fair a little bit in the tear up section this week, but it definitely it pushed me over the edge. Also, I got a collection of her strange animals and bestiary section, which I'm really excited for. Which is just collections of her
love her monsters so
fantasy
much.
Monsters that she makes.
So
I got the Center for Otherworld Science.
Oh yeah.
Oh.
It's a story about monsters and people. And it's just the cutest, most beautifully done. Like, because this art is not simple. It is incredibly
And those little people get really interesting.
The
storytelling, I'm a fan of that book, and the storytelling, Ask Out a Tiny Mushroom Pack.
For my proposal, when I proposed to Brittany, I hand wrote a story with ink and quill for her, like the story of the world where I was kidnapped and she was trying to save. And I showed it to Shing, just like I happened to have it with me. I was over there getting their help on a couple things. She's like, and she goes, "Do you want me to add some watercolors to this while you work with my husband?" And I was just like, "What?" She's like, "Yeah, like you're working with Jason on some stuff, but I'm bored, so I'm just gonna draw on your book." And I was like, "Okay."
Sounds like her.
And it's just, I'll bring it, I'll try to remember to bring it in for you. It's gorgeous work.
So,
yeah, like just insanely talented. She was able to do what she did with that book for me in an hour. While I was working on something else.
So
I think we should end with yours. Yeah. Show the two
keep going. Yeah, no, because I wish I had gotten that, because I needed one of those at some point that weekend.
Here's what it says on the back of this. This ridiculous bullshit brought to you by... and it is my custom packs of go on, fix that table, be a hero, shims.
Yes, it is a pack of shims.
It is a pack of small things to put under uneven things to make them sit better.
So
it's amazing, and she sells them at Comic-Con, and
I was staring.
I'm so excited.
I was staring at the pack of shims, and I thought about getting them, and I was like, when am I next going to need a shim? That very night, I was at a restaurant, and somebody got locked in the bathroom of the restaurant because they had not read the sign on the door that says, the door is broken, it cannot be opened, do not close the door. And then somebody had to come from the back and like shove the door open, and there was a splintering sound, it was terrible. And then they were like, how do I prop this door open now? Because people have to know. And I was like, if only I had bought those I was like, curse, I needed to have bought those shims. So I've been like, I have a pack of shims with me right now. And it would have been, I denied myself an amazing story. I denied it.
So the other thing I got was I met up with the Space Gnome Mercantile.
Very solid.
Trading post. These were not available for sale.
No.
These were available for trade for very specific specific. I saw a sign and it looked like it said don't sass, and I was like, you are barking up the wrong tree. Very specific trades. Interesting rock, story about your favorite roadside statue, or I think compliment in the form of a limerick or an iambic pentameter.
She got such a burner.
She got a teapot out of that trading. I remember she was posting pictures of a teapot. She's also, I will say, a huge Paul Bunyan fan, so that does not surprise me.
Yep, tall tales and mythology and art and wonderfulness. Mm-hmm. And I have my own little space gnome pin.
We should have her on sometime.
Oh, no, that's the plan. I love her. Plans.
So, yeah, what'd you get?
One of the other things that she was doing, again, this is like what I love about a good multimedia artist coming to Comic-Con, was she was selling sealed packs of three random tarot cards that she would make that are fortune cards. I was like, three fortunes in a sealed pack at random? When am I going to be around two other people to do this with? So I'm going to unlock. I'm now going to
open it. Oh, you haven't even opened it.
No, I'm going to break the seal.
Oh, how fun.
I'm breaking the seal right now, and it's such a beautiful seal, and I feel bad for because this is what she would have wanted. Ah!
If you can, you need a shim for this.
I was about to say, if only I had a shim to open this with. It's really hard. It's glued it shut. She might have used wood glue. I'm not sure. It might be the only glue she had. No, we've got to go from the top. Got to do it from like that. There we are.
There we go.
I got it. There we are.
Taliesin is stronger than me.
It's got fingernails. All right, so here we go. We have a letter. I'll give it a quick roll. This set of cards is very internal arc of new beginnings, self-doubt, healthy anger, the cracked. Okay, so we're gonna find out. All right, so pick a card. Mackie, pick a card.
Beautiful.
Pick one card. There we go. All right, so
can we flip it over?
You go first.
The twig wall.
All right, let's show it to everybody.
I got the twig wall. God, it's so pretty.
The twig wall is the acknowledgement that there are things that you are protecting. The thing that you are protecting is not as fragile as it seems. Interesting. You have built a lovely fortress, but this one does not get weaker as the walls become more porous. There's actually a whole build for about all three.
Wow.
Three here. Let's see what you got.
I got the cracked egg.
The cracked egg is about embracing a new definition of beauty and growth. That is a fabulous one. Oh, there's a whole build, and then that means I got the three-eyed rat.
What? Is it wrong that it's very cute?
The Three-Eyed Rat is a careful card, often linked to the natural hunters who must be aware and alert to avoid being outsmarted by their prey. Retain both your wits and your humility, and your natural gifts will allow you to attain unimaginable heights. At the same time, anger is a valid emotion and can be the source of strength and community. There's a whole breakdown of the entire three-card read there.
Wow.
The cracked egg, the twig ball, and the Three-Eyed Rat have keywords. Beauty, growth, and kindness. Honesty, fragility, and gratitude.
Mm-hmm.
Perceptiveness, growth, and conquest.
Ooh.
These are beautiful cards. These are stunning, stunning
those
cards.
Are beautiful.
But I was gonna say, I think you should hold on to your card, though.
Oh, thank you.
I think that's the only sane thing to do is hold on to your card.
This is wonderful. You are building something important. You are doing it with kindness and joy. And you hold a fundamental desire for you and everyone around you to be the best expression of humanity. This might be a pretty Wednesday Club fortune, guys.
Yeah, no, I'm very impressed.
I wanted to stop before I read this next sentence, which is funny because the next sentence is, you need to accept the love that is also directed to you and hold yourself worthy of it. We won't. We won't hold ourselves worthy of it.
No, that's not how we work.
You guys are too amazing. but maybe we'll think about it because this fortune told us to. How lovely.
So pretty.
I love these cards. They're spectacular.
Yeah, they are great.
So, yeah, this is always one of my favorite things at Comic-Con is to go see what new things she has at her booth.
My goodness.
To fill my house with lovely, lovely art.
Speaking of new things, how about I would like to talk about a few old things
now. Let's do something old.
Oh, my God.
So, should I do the really old or the moderately old, which you guys know what I'm talking about.
Let's do the moderately old, and then let's top it off with the really old.
Okay, so for the moderately old, I'm going to just quickly go through these. I'm very excited for them.
Mm-hmm.
I am a collector of older comics, but, like, I don't need them to be, like, 10-point or 9.8 or whatever. Like,
he means in terms of condition official grading scale.
The grading scale. I just want the comic. I just want a reading copy of the comic.
We call those reader copies. Yeah. Yep.
So I've got, this is one of my favorite Spider-Man stories. It's The Commuter Cometh. Cometh the Commuter. No, the Commuter in this instance is Spider-Man who chases a villain to the suburbs of New York City and discovers that his powers are limited.
Because there's no
giant buildings to crawl up or swing from. So he ends up just being,
oh my God,
a dude in a suit running through streets.
That's Spider-Man's like kryptonite is suburbs.
Yeah. And they featured this prominently in the movie in Homecoming.
Mm-hmm.
That was all taken from this story, the entire sequence in that neighborhood. And yeah, I was right. It's written by Peter David, one of my favorite writers from the 90s.
Such a sense of humor.
Very funny writer. Started off in Marvel's marketing department. And
wrote
became a writer.
X-Force.
Yeah.
X-Factor.
Yeah. I mean, he was writing. He wrote a lot of the X-Factor in the 90s. That book was canceled, and then when they brought it back around 2005, I think after the House of M event, he was brought back in for that. Let's do this one
first. Okay.
This is when Black Panther joins the Avengers. What's great about this comic is that it shows off how much of a badass Black Panther is. So
does he take him down Grim Reaper?
He does.
Ooh.
But wait, it's even better than that in this comic because Captain America invites him to join the Avengers, but you know, you have to come and talk to us. You need to be a fit for everybody. So he goes to Avengers Mansion and can't get in, and he's like, wait, I was invited. Why am I not able to get in? He figures out that security has somehow been triggered, so now he feels like he needs to get in to see if they need help.
Right.
Captain America told him about the secret entrances. He tries to get in through the secret entrance. All the fail safes come on, all the alarms go off, and he's able to disarm everything that's thrown at him, which no one should be able to do.
Right.
He gets inside to find three or four Avengers, like Hawkeye, Goliath, dead. They're legitimately dead. And he's like, why are these guys dead? What is going on? And he's got his mask off. Guess what happens next? Cops come in. They're like, freeze, you killed the Avengers. And it's like, oh, boy. Okay, we've got a black man standing over four dead bodies, and of course he goes to prison. He has to break out of prison, go back to Avengers Mansion, solve the mystery of who murdered everyone, then beat the Grim Reaper by himself, and then the rest of the Avengers team finally comes back to see he's escape prison to go back to Avengers Mansion, where she's able to break into. This all happens in one issue, by the way. And at the end of the issue, they're like, so, do you want to join the Avengers? It's like, a fucking course you want him to join. He should be. He's an Avenging team by himself.
This is happening.
No, do it. Do it. I'm glad that you're doing this because you know my rule.
Yeah.
I open it once for Brittany and myself, and I open it once for here.
Yep,
so.
Yep.
So I'm glad that you took the liberty.
God, the Grim Reaper's costume was such a disaster back then.
Yeah. So while you're doing that, because we're running out of time.
Yeah.
Adam Warlock, if I remember correctly, premiered as him in Fantastic Four, I think 67, like late 60s. I think it's 67, though.
His name was him.
But it was only him, and he was like 67 and 68. Then he disappeared, and he didn't come back for about a year. Then I believe it was Englehart who took over Marvel premiere number one, where he redefined Adam Warlock. This is where he got his actual name of Adam Warlock.
Amen, God reborn.
This is where, like, he's runs into the High Evolutionary. The High Evolutionary gives him the Soul Stone, but they don't fully know what it is. So this is also, the introduction of the Soul Stone is this comic,
nice. Which is the first,
which it would be the first appearance of an Infinity Stone in this comic. Then we've got the first appearance of the Star Jammers and Scott Summers' father, Corsair.
35-year-old spoilers.
Oh, wow.
So, I so love the Star Jammers. I was so excited to find that. Tim Drake is my favorite Robin because, let's all be honest, he's the best Robin. I've got Tim Drake's first appearance, but now I have Tim Drake's first appearance as Robin.
Nice!
So, back when he was in the Dick Grayson costume.
Yep.
DC Comics aren't just for kids.
So, two more. First appearance of Nova. Ba-ba-ba, the man called Nova.
Yay!
Super fun. And now, this is actually less exciting. And this is a warning story now. I looked up to see when the actual publication date was on this. This is a reprint from 1974.
I thought you knew. I'm sorry.
I did not know.
But it's still awesome.
It's an EC story. Oh, my God, it looks like it's in pristine condition. And then as I was looking at it when I got home, I was like, this is too pristine. I am now suspicious.
You're getting the eye.
So, yeah.
I forgot that Jasper Sitwell was in the story. Yeah. Oh, God,
isn't that
ridiculous.
Crazy? Yeah, S.H.I.E.L.D. agent Jasper Sitwell goes all the way back to the mid-70s.
It's still fabulous. It's just a different piece of comics history.
Exactly.
It's one of the first ways of them going back, reevaluating, and realizing
saying,
that those stories deserve to be part of
the larger
canon.
We should do this. Yeah, so it's from 1974, so it's still older than I am. But just be careful. Always...
By the way, Sitwell was always a jerk. Oh, my God.
He's always been a jerk. Yeah.
Such a jerk.
So that's
amazing.
That's that. We've got about 10 minutes left.
Okay. I also hit up the old stuff booth because since our previous conversation, I had to get myself an actual copy of it.
Oh, my God.
X-Men.
Oh, that's so awesome.
Together, having adventures.
Oh, that's so cool.
I need to check and make sure that these are actually something I can show on screen, but I found the booth with the undergrounds. I'm very excited.
Oh my God, that's like my parents' stuff right there. Oh man.
I'm gonna leave this extremely political one down here. But like, come on, guys.
Oh wow, no, that's exciting.
1973.
It's got the vibe.
This, which I'm so excited to crack this open because it is 1993, and it is early work by one of my all-time favorite cartoonists.
Oh my God.
This is Alison Bechdel, and it's all her characters from her cartoon strip making fun of her for not putting them, I think, in this issue at this booth I got his card because we're going to talk to him more about history because he had everything.
This is deep.
I'm so excited. That's old Trina Robbins.
Holy shit.
Wow.
Oh my God.
The first sort of like all female underground anthology, I think. They had a whole panel on that I wasn't able to go to, but there's a recording that I think is online.
That's such a cover.
Women's comics from the late 60s, early 70s. I love this. A frog going, kiss me. And she's going, can't see turning a perfectly good frog into a prince.
Oh.
So I had to stop myself from buying literally every issue, but I love this. Can you have it ready by next week? Betsy Ross had been planning to lead the troops up Bunker Hill. The special bicentennial issue of Women's Comics, so that would make it 1976.
Wow.
I'm very, very excited to dive
that's
into
so deep.
These portions of comic
book
history.
Oh, my God.
That's huge history, because that's when, like, independent comics were really just, like...
Before there was a direct market to support them, while they were still fighting out court cases about obscenity laws, some of the first, like, some of what I thought were the first contributors to comics, until this weekend, women in comics, where my world has been completely rocked.
Oh, yeah, this is... I was waiting for this to happen.
And I will go into this further at a different time because we don't have that much time left. But the absolute highlight, other than doing the panel with y'all, of my weekend was that... So Wonder Woman is one of my all-time favorite characters, but one of the things about her is that she was created by a bunch of dudes, a bunch of extremely feminist dudes who absolutely believed and fought for a lot of the things that I care about. And I love that about her. But one of those things was it would be a really long time before a woman actually got to write her.
Or so we thought. Oh, wow. I missed out on that.
Sorry. It wasn't a plan. We just got excited.
I just feel really bad.
I've gotten really good at this.
Yeah.
New thing.
Telling when I'm about to shout.
You speak Dallen.
Converting to stereo.
Yeah.
Where available.
So, it turns out.
Yeah.
Is this her?
Yeah.
So I went to this. Okay. At the Eisners, they talked about, they awarded, one of the awards for sort of underappreciated body of work was issued to a woman I had never heard of. Some scholars did know her name, that they were already aware of her as sort of an assistant to William Moulton Marston, the creator of Wonder Woman. As it turns out, in addition to assisting him, she actually wrote the book with him and sometimes instead of him for years, for about 3.5 years, she worked directly with Dr. Marston, making sure that Wonder Woman's stories met their standards and expressed what they wanted to say about the world.
Whoa. That's so cool.
She did her first ever Comic-Con appearance, and she did a live panel and a surprise signing afterwards. And I am... I didn't bring anything because I didn't expect it to happen. So I had a random index card from playing D&D in my backpack.
I love you.
It's got someone's initiative order on the back. And on the front, it has best wishes to Amy from Joy Murchison Kelly. I am literally crying in this picture, in case you wonder. I think I frightened her.
So the most appropriate way to frame that is to find one of those issues that she wrote and put it in the frame with it.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yep.
It's just unbelievable to me because she just shared her perspective, and we will go into it another time. But she explicitly said that she said at the Eisners too that she thought that Dr. Marston would be so happy to see so many women flourishing in comics and telling their stories. But I think the words she used were so many gals doing their thing. Because she's from the 40s, and it's the best. And I should have left more time because I had all those quotes that I read you guys at the panel that are in my phone. But please promise me that we can come back.
Oh
to
my
this
God, story. We are so Absolutely. Coming back to this. Are you kidding?
Because it was just an extraordinary experience to get to be in the room listening to her talk about. Literally writing Wonder Woman in the 1940s, and I didn't know she existed. And she happened to tell us that the artist Terry G. Peter had two female assistants, and the lettering team was a married couple. So the creative team of Wonder Woman in the 40s, if I'm doing the math right, was more than half female. None of their names were on it, but it was the 40s, baby steps. Mm-hmm. So that's my treasure. There's so much more. I bought T-shirts, I bought pins, I bought other comics. I bought everything at the Doctor Who booth. It was a problem.
Oh, wow,
I got
yeah.
this.
Aww.
Which was Aww. A present to me, and it turns out, Ryan North had never seen this one. And there's so much more good stuff happened at Comic-Con, y'all.
A fan, and please forgive me, I don't remember who you are, so please hit us up on Twitter and let us know, or if you're in the chat. But they brought us Mobius cards. To open, and I thought you guys should open those.
I'm into that. I'm ready for this.
Yeah,
ready?
Do it.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Oh, I think I'd be better at this by now for all the years I've been.
They're so pretty.
You need help, buddy?
Yeah. Wow. Apparently, I do. I'm all thumbs. My imagination.
This one is tricky.
Here, yeah. This is Mobius.
Oh, here we go.
Drawing of Mobius.
Oh, that's cool.
That's a Mobius. Ooh, got it open. Oh, I'm so excited. Let's see what we got. Oh, look at that. God, that's so beautiful.
Pretty. Oh, those are just pretty cards. Those are good quality.
The Green Man.
Oh,
lovely.
Look at that.
That's so good.
Oh. This is
Jasper, an adorable monster.
Oh, that's fantastic. Oh, gorgeous.
Oh, these are lovely.
Airtight Garage, which is a classic. Just a bloody classic. Oh, look at the thumb. The thumb in the picture is lovely.
Oh my goodness.
Dear God, the monster. Oh, we got two green monsters. Oh, I love, I will admit there's something about older cards and the way they're just a little sticky.
A little sticky.
Here's the checklist.
Nice. Ooh, everyone needs a checklist.
Balinfor, I'm trying to.
Lady Kowalski.
He's Skinner, you're
who
not,
appeared in The Horny Goof, which is a fantastic title.
The Whites of the. Oh, here's one. This is really doing it for me.
Oh, God.
Look at that. That's nuts. That's beautiful.
Oh, that's so pretty.
I want to ride a giant insects.
What a talent.
Amazing.
Prince Charming and the Phoenix, 1973. Oh, God. Okay, yeah.
I am very excited to show this off. I didn't know this was a thing. This is from Sunday Press is the name of the company I bought this at.
He surprised us with this at the panel and we lost our minds.
I didn't even know you could buy this at the convention, and this will be one of the first things I go to next year. I cannot believe this. So remember how comic books were first created in 1934, 35 with Famous Funnies, where they collected the big newspaper strips from the newspapers and they condensed them down and they put them in a, like they stapled the pages. And they gave them away for free as a sales thing. And then was it the major?
Wheeler Nicholson? Will,
who was like, what if I charge 5 cents for this? Kids would pay a nickel for this. And then they did. It was like, oh, okay, let's keep doing that. So until Superman, they were collections, more or less. Like Detective, I guess that's not actually true. Detective Comics started doing their thing, but that's how it started. Well, this is Sunday, May 8th, 1938. This is a year after Prince Valiant started. This is an actual page from an actual newspaper.
Hal Foster's Prince Valiant, one of the most famous comic strips of all time, a huge influence on the artist who would follow it.
Jack Kirby, Ditko, like all the majors were influenced by Prince Valiant.
This is literally that page of newspaper. This is unbelievable.
Yeah.
From 1938.
And it's from 19. This is before Superman was ever published. And then I also wanted to get.
Oh, gentle.
This is January of 1937. Silly Symphonies, Donald Duck, and as Taliesin pointed out, Hobo Goofy.
Hobo Goofy.
Yeah.
This is this is history. And here's what's amazing about this. The guy that I talked to, I can't remember his name was Pete, because I was like, Peter Parker, I'll remember that. His name was Pete. He started doing this because years ago, he realized that no one was saving these.
Mm-hmm.
And he started contacting libraries who had them preserved in their back rooms. And they were like, well, we've actually started throwing some of them out because there's not records. We've got microfiche.
There's a whole other episode about the changing goals and methods of preservation and how libraries and archivists over time have realized, like, and pursued. Anyway, there's a whole history behind this, but yes.
So he started contacting libraries and other resources around America and collecting them on his own.
In
some cases, they were free, stuff like that, but he started getting them, and he would try to find as many copies of a page as he could so he could scan it, but then have other copies to sell or keep for posterity or for other reference. And he was telling me some of the stories, like, he's got pages from 1909, he's got pages, like, I really wanted to get was Nemo and Dreamland, but those were a little more out of my price range. And when I say price range, that page was $10.
This is unbelievable.
Prince Valiant was $10. And I told the guy, I asked the guy, I was like, hey, where are you based out of? He's based out of Palo Alto, and he comes down to LA all the time, and he said he would love to do our show.
Ooh.
And in fact, he has a PowerPoint presentation specifically for that. And when he brought me over to one of his oversized books and started going through the history of it, I was like, I was blown away by what this guy knows. I cannot wait to do an episode with this guy about, like, the pre-golden age of comics.
Mm-hmm.
I'm blown away by this guy. So in love with this man.
I have to add that we do have to send 15 cents to Tilly's pattern department to get a doll and dress by Miss Viola Boston 241.
Oh, jeez.
Show it off.
Yeah.
All right, and this is the last thing because we do need to do our topic. Oh, I should actually look at what that is. Is that I'm guessing that's in here?
Mm. Oh. And I can do this one pretty easily. One more thing that I got on the Comic-Con floor.
There's an ad for Tilly the Tailor right there, which is a cutout doll dress that you send 15 cents in an envelope. It's amazing. Oh. I can't even.
So cool.
Yep, that's magical.
Yeah, that is. I went by the Her Universe booth and got this amazing Captain Marvel jacket, and I love it so much.
It's so pretty.
It's warm in here.
It's
so
as if it was made for you.
Are you guys ready for our 5-minute topic?
I don't know. Let's find out.
Probably only slightly ready.
Do you want to introduce it and then I'll read it off?
Welcome to the Wednesday Club. This is our 5-minute topic where you all make us decide on something. My name is Amy Dallen.
I'm Taliesin Jaffe.
My name is Matt Key.
And what is today's topic?
Our topic comes from I'm Cillian. You have to make a camp for Burning Man from comic book characters. Choose 5 people to be in camp with.
Oh, God. I'm at a distinct disadvantage here.
And
these
go.
These are hardcore Burning Man fans.
It basically is the same rules of who do you want to, like, spend the post-apocalypse with, except
in the desert.
In the desert.
Because whatever you brought, you just make whatever you need.
See, already
solid
you're good at this.
Choice.
I'm just going to start with the fun. I want Jubilee. She's just there, and we've got fireworks, and that's great. Jubilee is built for Burning Man.
Will someone else please say Doctor Strange so I don't have to be the one to say Doctor Strange? Because, come on, Doctor Strange at Burning Man is kind of a no-brainer, but I'm not allowed to say that.
See, I want to say Dr. Fate just because I know he won't enjoy it, but, like...
No, I don't want to go to Burning Man with Dr. Fate. That's a terrible idea.
Dr. Fate would have a bad time at Burning Man.
He would hate it.
He would have a bad time for everybody else. Oh, yeah.
It's going to be a bad time. I think Doctor Strange would be great out there. I can't say that. So someone else say it.
Do you think Doctor Strange likes to have all his stuff covered in dust?
No, but like he would just be so much fun doing like sorcery and magic out there. And
I'd
like
away the dust.
I mean, like, yeah, he'd be like, dust go away. Nightcrawler would be great out there because he could bamf us to the man and to the temple and then out to like deep playa.
That'd be very convenient.
I really want to go see that one art installation. It's like 8:15 in E.
Yeah.
I will get you that, my friend. Bamf. Yeah, that would be super fun.
And you're already kind of nauseous just from being there, so that's okay.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And like it already smells of brimstone a bit.
Yeah, a
not
little bit.
Actually, but
yeah, something or other.
Dazzler.
I was thinking Dazzler.
She would be so fun out there. I mean, like, sans the roller skates. She wouldn't get anywhere with roller skates. But not in the dust.
I don't even know how to fight this.
No, but, like her power, because of her power, like...
Dazzler's power is to turn sound into dazzling light shows.
But, like, every... So imagine, how many camps would you say are out there? Like...
Oh, too many.
Like, what... So let's say... So
Burning Man is an annual festival where they make a city in the desert and a bunch of people do art stuff and trade things.
So imagine that there are like 100 cars all made to be completely weird animals and dragons and whatever else. But they're all playing their own soundtrack. And then every single camp that's out there, let's say on average there's 8,000 camps out there, they're all playing their own music.
It's a lot of music.
So Dazzler is surrounded constantly by sound. She would be like Super Saiyan... Super Saiyan, Super Scion.
Super Saiyan, you're fine.
Super Scion,
like Saiyan. Just saying.
She's not a car.
She's not a Scion. She would be an Omega Mutant out there. She'd be like, oh my God.
I can, and like, she would definitely be preferable to Marvel Boy, who I think would just be like the worst DJ. Like, he would
judge every music.
And yet his DJing would be terrible.
Fair.
I'd
go with Lois. I'd love to see it through her eyes. Like, I'd love to be like the year that she goes to document Burning Man, to like just do a, you know, Lois and Jimmy, like doing a field report on what Burning Man is. I'd love to see it through their eyes.
I have another
one. I have some supervillains. I would like to go with the Brotherhood of Dada.
Of course,
I think
you
they would.
Would
run a great camp.
Oh, they would have a great camp. They would have the best camp.
No, the Brotherhood of Dawn didn't murder people. Okay. They mostly one of their great crimes was Mr. Nobody dressed up like Santa Claus and started giving away free toys at Toys R Us, and then got like arrested violently by the cops. He's like, all these children now have memories of policemen beating up Santa Claus and will not respect authority for the rest of their lives. So like literally, they're just anarchists
in the best way.
Yeah.
Beast Boy would fuck with some people.
That'd be great.
Like there are illicit substances out there, and Beast Boy would be like, "What are you talking about? I'm an elephant. I'm not an elephant."
That's so mean.
But it's so funny. And Burning Man is Burning Man is built on trolling each other. In good spirit.
I want to see Batman and Burning Man. I do.
You don't.
He would never admit to having a good time, but he would.
I don't think he would.
I think he would.
I think he would have a terrible time.
We're gonna read Starman, and I'm gonna change your mind about Batman.
Stare into the desert and be like, "There's crime here. Somewhere."
He would get everybody doing the bat dance. He'd be like, he'd be very angry for the first 5 days, and by the end, he'd be doing
Batman 66 would have a blast out there.
He would bring his inner Batman 66 out, I feel.
Grant Morrison Batman would have fun out
of
there.
Of course. What's the best Batman?
How would Alfred take to the challenges of running a camp at Burning Man?
Alfred's been to Burning Man and still goes.
Yeah.
It's a secret advice for him.
I do.
He goes to the festival every single year, and Bruce Wayne just knows that.
I didn't think he works the festival. I actually think he's part of infrastructure.
Ooh, night nurse would be great out there, in the hospital.
Yeah,
I would want to go with her.
We got to wrap this up, though.
All of them.
X-Force has been.
Jimmy Olsen and the Forever People practically were Burning Man before there was Burning
Man. That's true.
Yeah.
Oh, God, we're out of time, even though we're making these great points.
So that's been our five-minute one-shot topic on the Wednesday Club. You can watch us every single Wednesday night at 7 o'clock on the Geek & Sundry Twitch, as well as VOD on ProjectAlpha.com. I'm Matt Key.
I'm Taliesin Jaffe.
I'm Amy Dallen.
All right, we've got 3 minutes left.
Thank you.
Liz, do you want to show off your take?
Let's show really quickly. This was apparently, we were amazed to find some art in the dealer's room of producer Liz. Until we found out, no, that's actually Jessica Jones. But still, it's a very remarkable take. I'm quite pleased.
And then Chief
came down for a day.
The Savage
Look at
She-Hulk,
this.
Number one.
Chief had some great finds. He told me I could have these, by the way. I was very...
Did he?
Yep, he totally did.
We're going to get our feed cut. You know that, right? He has the buttons.
This is the first appearance of Yellow Jacket.
Yay!
And if you know anything about Chief, you know that he is a giant fan of Hank Pym and Ant-Man.
He's a giant fan of Giant Man.
I have two comics I can't read without opening this wax seal.
Ooh!
That Silver Sprocket, one of my new favorite publishers, does. There was a comic I was in front of. It's called Siren School, and it makes me laugh. And I was like, this is one of my favorite comics ever. And this woman went, thank you. And I was like, oh, it's yours. Because I was just at the publisher booth.
Yeah.
So I didn't even realize I was literally saying that in front of the woman who wrote and drew it. So I bought everything else she has.
There's also a bunch of clothes. And I think we're going to have to, at some point, if people are into it, I want to do a whole, I think we could do like at least one, if not several episodes, just on comic books and clothes.
Like the relationship.
Fashion.
But the best part was meeting all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
It was amazing.
It's humbling, the outpouring that we get from you. So, and the Wasp. Well, who's Wasp Matt? I've never heard of Wasp Matt.
Wasp Matt.
He said.
Don't you talk to me about punctuation? So I guess we're gonna stay tuned for some Weave, which is coming up in a little bit.
Goblins are jerks. And then next week, we will have our episode, unfortunately, without Matt, as we get ready to Gen Con.
I'll be out there helping set up the Critical Role booth with my lovely wife.
Oh, are you guys doing something at Gen Con?
Maybe. Probably. I'm really tired.
Are we going?
Are we going? I think that's our time. We've got our cue. The vortex is opening.
Thank you so much for watching. We'll see you next time.
Bye.